Hey, Kevin Martin here, your UT admissions guy, filming this video today from Pai, which is a small town in northern Thailand. So I know 2022 is already off to a bit of a rough start for a lot of you, and if you're watching this video, it's probably because you did not gain admission to UT Austin. So for those of you who did get in the previous days and weeks, I want to wish you congratulations. I hope UT Austin is a top choice on your college search, and if you were admitted, then it's important to visit campus, begin doing your housing application, making inquiries about summer orientation, etc. And so this video is primarily about those students who received a lot of disappointing news today. As of about 30 minutes or an hour ago, it seems like UT has started releasing their wave of cap decisions. I'm following it closely. I'm like refreshing the subreddit to see what the outcomes are. It seems like everything right now is cap. There might be some acceptances that go out. I think a lot of out-of-state students are still waiting. Definitely a lot of honors decisions like Plan 2, BHP touring. Most or none of those have gone out yet, depending on the program. I know BHP and Plan 2, I think, have admitted a few students, but most of the other honors programs are probably not going to go out this weekend. Maybe they will. Honors kind of does their own thing. So for those of you who have been admitted and are waiting for their honors outcomes, I wish you all the best. But like I say, this video is for those disappointed, thousands of disappointed students who are already asking me questions like, how should I appeal? How does the transfer process work? Or maybe I'm a top 6% student that wasn't given their first or second choice major. What should I do? And so this video is, I think, the sixth one of these I've done. So I've done this video every year since 2016. Every single year. The UT admissions process does not go smoothly. There's always going to be hiccups. UT is a notoriously non-transparent institution. Even for example, when you refresh, I'm just like refreshing their Instagram, their Twitter, and their UT Enrollment Management YouTube channel. Like, nobody knows what enrollment management means except like bureaucrats. Enrollment managers are the people that pull the strings. Like, it's a factually correct YouTube title, but like the general public doesn't know what enrollment management is. Like, they're looking for the UT Office of Admissions YouTube channel. But you know, it's just a part of not just UT, but this is a trend of universities across the nation, as they're using their social media platforms simply to promote their own brands, to persuade those really high achieving admitted students to enroll. But the objective on social media or even on their mailing lists is not to inform, it's not to provide data, it's not to answer many of the frequently asked questions that families have. And so instead, the public has to resort to third-party websites like mine or other consultants to fill that information gap. And so this year is no different. Like, we still don't know how many students apply. We don't know how many were admitted. They never release information about, for example, how selective computer science or business or electrical and computer engineering. We don't know any of that data, and we haven't had any of that data for many years. And so usually I wait to record this video until we have a little bit more information and statistics. But because I'm already getting tons of questions about appeals and about transfer, the reality of UT admissions, and I'll talk about this a little more, is that it's simply extremely competitive, right? Whether there were 60,000 applications or 65,000 or 70,000, it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. I mean, for younger students who are watching this, the thing to understand is that UT Austin in particular, and this is true of any top 50 university in the United States, it's just extremely competitive. It's hard to get into. Nobody can tell you why you did or didn't get in, why a given classmate with lower grades or a subjectively less good resume, why they got in and you didn't. I just got an email from a parent, like, pretty crazy. He's like, oh, like, I have twin boys, like, they're like 3 rank difference. They're both like 35, 36 ACT, like, both have basically the same resume and activities. One was admitted to CS and the other one was denied to CS. And so you have these really inexplicable outcomes. I even this year for the first time I had like extremely academically qualified students that I was for sure, like, certain that they were going to get in. For example, like, one who was ranked like in the top 10 out of 1,000 with a 36 on the ACT, didn't get into biomedical engineering, but they did get into a top 20 private university. What I've noticed for students that, and this has been true definitely since COVID for sure, but in the last 3 or 4 years, is that stellar academics, like top 1%, 1550, is nowadays it's almost necessary to get in, but it's not sufficient, meaning that great academics with a thin resume, particularly for programs like computer science and some of the more selective engineering majors like electrical computer or computational biomedical chemical, it's also pretty tough. But even selective majors like neuroscience and also nursing and architecture, super hard majors to get into. If you don't have a deep commitment already for example, having a really deep STEM resume or a wide variety of computer science, coding, programming adjacent activities like robotics, if you aren't already doing those things by your freshman year, the reality is like you're not going to get in, right? Like that's what's happening with my top academic clients who obviously had good essays because we worked together, but they had thinner resumes. And in years past, it's like, oh, like you're like number two, you're 36, like you're probably going to get in, but I think those days might be over. And then conversely, I do have clients that are outside the top 6% with, say, a 1450 who have a really deep commitment to business. They've done DECA ICDC. They have a lot of volunteering. They've started a nonprofit, whatever, who are getting in, right? So that's one of the frustrations and ambiguities of holistic review is that you just don't know what it takes to get in. And I think in particular, my first and second generation immigrant families who were educated in other cultures, like in China or in India, where although those processes are also extraordinarily competitive, at least you know what it takes to get in, right? If you're in the top 0.1% of test scores, like you can get into Indian Institute of Technology, you can get into Tsinghua University in China, or you go to Seoul University in South Korea. But the frustration about the American system is like you just simply don't know what it takes to get in. And so it just circles back that for those of you who are in this kind of like grief processing phase to try and find explanations or look for variables or identify reasons or causes why you get in and someone else didn't, like it's a really frustrating road to go down because nobody can explain to you why you did or didn't get in. A lot of it just comes down to luck. It comes down to the mood of your admissions reviewers, the needs of the university, the number of spaces available in a given program. And so I get a lot of those messages this time of year, and I don't really have anything to say other than like I'm sorry that it didn't work out. I know many students understandably tie their self-worth and validation to these admissions outcomes because you've worked really hard for 4, 5, 6, 10 years to try and get to this point. And I know for many students in Texas, UT is the top option, right? Like A&M and UT Dallas offer great academic options, but they're not everyone's first choice for a variety of reasons and different reasons for the case of UTD and A&M. So I'm thankful that Texas, that we do have a lot of solid public university options, but we're not California with Berkeley and LA and San Diego and Irvine, et cetera. And so for many people, it's kind of UT or, distant second and third choices. So those are conversations I'm having right now, of course. Conversations about CAP, which we can talk about. So CAP, for those of you that don't know, it means you got rejected. Okay? Like, it means you got rejected. And it's someone pointed out on Reddit, it's a little bit ironic that UT releases all of their admissions rejections on like 7 p.m., 6:30, 7 p.m. on a Friday when like offices are closed. And so like you can't actually call them. And so you can't call them, you can't email them. So then people just like email me instead. And I don't have anything honestly to say other than it's disappointing. But CAP is a rejection. It means you did not get into UT Austin. Okay. It's another one of those almost like kind of public relations things where it's like, oh, well, like we'll tell you that you got CAP. And so some people are like, oh, cool, I got CAP, which is like awesome. Like, I'm glad you have that perspective because it is a great option for certain students, right? If you like non-top 6% applying to liberal arts and you didn't get in, CAP might be a pretty good option because that guarantees psychology, economics, which are really popular options. And those majors are very, very hard to get into if you're trying to go from one university to another. For those of you who are STEM, CAP is not a good option. Business CAP is not a good option because CAP does not offer a pathway. It does not offer any advantages in the transfer process. All that it guarantees is if you have a 3.2 GPA at a UT institution, you can transfer automatically into liberal arts. Otherwise, all the other majors are competitive. And so some people, oh, if I do CAP, am I more competitive for business? The answer is no. The other thing about CAP is they will open up the portal at a certain time. On your My Status page, they may have already told you this. I haven't seen it myself yet. But if you want UT San Antonio or UT Arlington, which is by far the two most popular options, you have to log in like and accept your CAP offer within maybe a minute or two. I think last year the space is literally filled up within 5 minutes. That means like multiple devices, like all hands on deck, all the family like hitting refresh, and that's how CAP works. Otherwise, you're going to have to go to UT Tyler or Permian Basin or Rio Grande Valley, which is, if you're from the Valley, from West Texas, East Texas, that could be a really good option for you. But for your urban, suburban families in Dallas, Austin, San Antonio, Houston, if you're not getting Arlington, San Antonio, CAP may not be a good fit for you either. CAP is also not a good fit for students with lots and lots of dual credit or AP. So if you have, say, more than 30 hours of dual credit or AP, CAP is not a good option for you because you have to take 15 hours in the fall, 15 hours in the spring, and it has to be part of like kind of a narrow core curriculum. So if you've already finished most or all of your core curriculum, like if you're an early college high school graduate, CAP is not a good option for you. I think about 2,000 or 2,500 students do CAP each year, and about 700 will enroll through that pathway. So it's a sizable amount. It usually accounts for about a third of UT's external transfer population each year. So look, I know it sucks to go to another UT school for a year, but if you think about it, like in 5 years or 10 years from now, like that year at San Antonio or Arlington or Rio Grande Valley, it's going to seem like kind of a distant memory. So I would say if you do want liberal arts, CAP could be a good option. If you just want to go to UT and you don't care what degree you get, CAP could be a good option. Yeah. The second thing people are asking me about is appeals. Okay, that's like the thing I get the most questions about by far this year at this time of year. I have a blog post, a comprehensive blog post, textadmissions.com/appeals. You can find that link in the information section of this video. I'm also uploading this video raw, so I'm not doing any editing or like links embedded in the video or anything. So this is also stream of consciousness. I'm just talking. But so appeals, right? Right. So the number one thing you have to understand about appeals is appeals, 99% of the time, have nothing to do with you as an applicant. Nothing. Doesn't matter, really, like if you update your application with new and significant information. It doesn't matter if you increased your rank. It doesn't matter if you, I don't know, report a new SAT, which they're probably not going to consider anyway. It doesn't matter if you really, really, really want to go to UT Austin. It even doesn't matter if you have a twin and your twin was rejected and you were admitted and your twin wants to, sibling wants to appeal. That used to be a pathway in the past. That pathway is no longer an option as of, I think, 2 years ago. A UT professional emailed me and told me that that wasn't a pathway. Another pathway that you could have done in the past but you can't do anymore is if you have lots of dual credit hours to appeal to be considered as a transfer student. That pathway is no longer open as of, I think, 3 or 4 years ago. And so appeals have nothing to do with you, okay? So when people ask me, like, what is your advice for appeals? Like, you'll see on my blog post, I'm like, it really doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter what you write in the appeals essay, unless there truly was a genuine mistake. Like, the registrar of your high school put your rank as 100 instead of 10, like they added a zero, okay, then yeah, that was an actual mistake that was made. But again, 99% of the time, it's not a mistake being made. It's just like, I really, really, really want to go to UT, and I, you know, think I'm a deserving applicant, and I have a great profile, let me in. Right, so if it doesn't matter about you as an applicant, all that it matters is UT's institutional needs to fill the spaces in their majors, right? So, you know, UT sort of uses appeals as like a wait list, as far as I can tell. And then I think in the previous 2 years, there was like hundreds of students that got in on appeals. So like, but in previous years, like zero kids get in on appeals, right? So you really can never tell. And so what I tell families nowadays is, look, don't agonize over the appeals essay. Just write a paragraph or two. If you want to request a less competitive major like education or computer communications, do that. Yeah, like, don't hire someone to help you on your appeal. Like, I haven't offered that service, I think, in 5 years. I used to do it, like, my first 2 years, and I realized, like, oh, man, I just don't like preying on people's or exploiting people's vulnerabilities for a service that I don't feel like I can add any value. And there's people out there that will charge, like, thousands of dollars for appeals, and they'll say, oh, I have insider access, or I'm, like, some privileged position at UT. It's bullshit. Don't hire anybody for appeals. I don't offer that service. I've had people who've offered me, like, lots of money to help on appeals. And I'm just like, no, I'm just not going to do that. That's a boundary I've drawn professionally, and it's not one I'm willing to cross. I also don't offer phone calls. Like, I used to offer phone calls probably 3 years ago and later, but like, people paying money just like yell at me. It's just not productive. And so for those of you who have gotten this bad news, like, just give it a few days to cool off, right? Like, you don't need to submit the appeal ASAP. You don't even need to submit an appeal in the first week or two. Like, it really doesn't matter, right? So I think that's my advice. Just like, submit an appeal, see what happens. It's a free option, so to speak. Don't agonize over the essay component. Don't go asking all your teachers for recommendation letters. That's a waste of your time. It's a waste of their time. The biggest downside of appeals that I see is not practical. It's more psychological. I find people use appeals as kind of this like last stage of bargaining where they're like, oh, it's like my final shot and like maybe I can hold out hope. And then it just drags into February and March and April, sometimes into May, and like, that's the biggest downside of an appeal, is it just doesn't allow students and families to move on, and you're kind of holding out for this Hail Mary last resort. So look, appeal, but understand that there is a psychological downside. It doesn't seem I'll totally be able to detach myself from the outcome, but then like, you read the UT Austin subreddit and it's just like, when is my appeal going to hear back? And like, people are still refreshing, and it's just like, man, maybe it's time to move on. Apply to other universities who still have later deadlines. Consider the options you've already received. Begin, you know, making campus visits. But You know, so that's my spiel on appeals. It doesn't matter what you write. It doesn't matter who you are. It just UT is just using you to fill butts and seats, okay? And that's the premise of my new book, Surviving the College Admissions Madness, is, you know, universities, like, they really don't care about you. Institutions, they care about their bottom line. They care about attendance. They care about diversity. They care about athletes. They care about, you know, really academically stellar students. But, like, 90% of you, like, it's a really unfortunate thing to say, and I feel like it's almost like a callous thing to say, but institutions don't care about you. They just don't. Individual professors might, academic advisors might, even individual admissions counselors might have given you very good concierge, but, you know, and appeals capture that. Appeals capture that, right? It's everything about the university's needs and not yours. So that's true of waitlists. That's true of any other university that's deferred you, for example. It's a tool in the enrollment manager's kit to fill those last available spaces. So don't bother. If you got computer science, biomedical engineering, like, you can try and appeal. Like, maybe you'll get lucky, but, like, everybody wants those spaces, right? You're having an increasing bifurcation between STEM and non-STEM programs at universities. Like, we have a society that says, like, everybody needs to do STEM. Like, learn how to code. Like, learn to program. Do robotics. Like, be a woman in STEM. Like, these are all great things until you go at the university level and there's not enough supply to meet the demand that's being generated, obviously, from private sector, but also just kind of like our societal values, right? We just, as a society in the past decades, just don't value non-STEM degrees anymore, which I think is really unfortunate. Liberal arts education was great for me. But what that means is if you're a STEM applicant, you're a younger student family watching this video, you have to have a really, really deep STEM resume or you're just not going to get in. That's just the reality, you know? I had a computer science client this year, like top 2%, 1590. You know, it was a really talented musician, didn't have a lot else going on, and they didn't get into computer science. And that's just the reality of it. So if you were a late bloomer or just junior, senior year, you decide you want to do computer science, like, you know, I try, see, but it's more likely you're going to go to a less selective university, less competitive university. And STEM programs everywhere are getting way more competitive. Even A&M is getting a lot more selective than it has in previous years. So, right. The final thing people ask me about this time of year is transfer, right? The first thing is don't go to ACC. If you're not from Central Texas, don't go to ACC. There's no reason to pay, like, stupid money for out-of-county tuition at ACC and, like, renting an apartment. It just doesn't make any sense, right? If you're from Austin, yeah, obviously go to ACC. It makes sense. But going to ACC doesn't help you at all in the admissions process. UT doesn't give any advantage to ACC. Like, I have a blog post about this. Like, ACC doesn't help your admissions chances because it's probably the most frequently asked question I get right now. Yeah, students out there trying to convince your parents to let you go to ACC so you can, like, join a frat and, like, party, like, yeah, I don't mean to rain on your parade, but if you're a parent, like, sending your kid to ACC so they can, like, be more mature, like, I don't know, I just would challenge you to have you know, honest conversations about why you really want to do this, you know, besides attending your local community college or enrolling immediately at a four-year university. So ACC doesn't make a difference. It doesn't matter if you go to a two- or a four-year institution. So if you're thinking, like, oh, should I go to A&M? Is it easier to transfer in to A&M or Lone Star College or Collin College? It doesn't matter. The only, like, small advantage you might get by going to an A&M or a Purdue is that maybe you could take more advanced, like, computer science or math classes that may not be an option for you at community college. Or if you have, like, a bunch of APs and dual credit, like Lone Star, Collin College, ACC may not be a good fit. But UT doesn't give a preference whether you go to a two-year or four-year university. That's the first thing to consider, FAQ I get a lot. The other thing is that, like, external transfer is also super, super competitive, right? So it's like the spaces for CS, biomed engineering, nursing architecture, forget about it. Never going to be able to transfer to nursing architecture. They admit, like, one student a year. Yeah, it's still super hard. If you want to transfer, like, you have to have straight A's. If you want to transfer to STEM program, like, maybe one B tops. You need lots of rigorous STEM courses, advanced math if you can. And then, yeah, continue building that resume. You can use your resume going back 5 years. And so a common mistake transfers make is they omit, like, everything they did in high school. And they've only been in university for one semester or a year. So include everything from high school. It's a separate process, totally different essays. They don't look at anything from high school. So your ranked test scores, those don't matter anymore. So in a way, like, transfer can be a fresh start. So for those of you that were, like, second quarter, you know, transfer can be, like, a kind of a reset button where if you want to earn those A's in college, university, that can be a really good choice. So, you know, be open-minded to transferring, but also, of course, be open-minded to, like, enrolling at a university that, like, wants to have you, that's maybe giving you really good scholarships, that's rolled out the red carpet, that's giving you legitimate concierge and not just, like, this BS social media, like, oh, look, I'm Bevo in front of a fire. you know, so go to a place that wants you, right? Like, you don't want to be, same with appeals, like, you don't want to be, like, a prom date, like, third person they ask. You know, like, no one wants to be, like, the last person picked for the team. So, yeah, so if you want to transfer, I also will put the link in the information section of this video. It's just textadmissions.com/transfer guide. It has anything and everything you might want to know about transferring. I begin working with transfer clients once they have at least some college hours taken. So for those of you wanting spring 2023 transferring, which is another FAQ I get a lot this time of year, you can only go if you're liberal arts, natural sciences, education, social work. So only a few majors admit for the spring. And I start taking on spring clients usually like end of the summer. So if you do want spring, it's probably a good idea to enroll at summer school so you can begin accumulating those grades and credit hours. You need 24 hours minimum to apply. No GPA guarantees admission. The average GPA is about a 3.7, 3.75 university-wide. But for CS engineering, yeah, like 3.954. Business, anything less than a 3.9, 3.95, like really tough to get in to UT, like maybe if you have a stellar resume or interesting life experience. The other question I get is internal transfer. So for those of you who were not admitted for a second choice major, but you were given, say, liberal arts communications, I have another blog post for that, internal, textadmissions.com/internal. I'll include that in the information section of this video. Internal transfer is a really big, it's a really big gamble, right? If you want STEM, if you want CS, you want business, it is super hard to get those programs. So for my STEM students, business students, it's probably better to just go to Mays, Jindal Business School at UTD, go to Purdue, University of Houston Honors, right? It's probably better to enroll into a university where you have a pathway to complete your degree, because UT is by no means certain. If you want to just Google like internal transfer on the UT Austin subreddit, UT Austin Missions 2 subreddit, yeah, you'll see lots of horror stories. Like people with 4.0s like getting rejected to like math, like not even like hard or in-demand majors. So internal transfer, whew, tough road, really tough road. If you're non-STEM major, yeah, internal transfer, communications, education, no big deal, right? As long as you just don't totally bomb your freshman year, like you'll probably be okay. But everything's different when you're a STEM student, and that's just the bifurcation, the splitting that's happening within higher education. So, right, so it covered brief overview of admissions. We still don't know the data. I'll refresh the subreddit right now and see if anyone has heard back, or if it's still all big fat rejections. Let's see. Cap, 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 cap. Oh, wait. Is that person got admitted? Oh, nope, I got capped. Yep, still lots of caps. So we'll see if any admissions decisions go out. So